As we approach the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon landing this July, the future of human spaceflight is at a crossroads. The world's space agencies have largely turned their attention and focus towards the moon, with NASA recently announcing Project Artemis, a plan to return astronauts to the lunar surface by 2024. But against this backdrop, the very way we access space is undergoing a transformation. For in the last few years alone, relatively young private companies have managed to reduce launch costs and achieved feats of engineering that even the oldest space agencies have yet to emulate. In these changing times, it appears that commercial endeavors could become the catalyst enabling the next giant leap into the solar system. In today's Mars Mission Update, we're going to be focusing on one organization that is actively working towards and determined to send people to Mars in the near future, SpaceX. We'll cover their first steps towards launching astronauts into space and the beginning of the Starlink constellation, which could ultimately fund missions to Mars. Finally, we'll see all the very latest developments on the spacecraft they are designing to send people to Mars as the first prototypes enter the testing phase. SpaceX, a private company founded by Elon Musk, has the stated goal of enabling people to live on other worlds. With ambitious plans to open a new frontier in spaceflight, they have the goal of sending people to Mars in the 2020s. They envision this leading to a sustained human presence, an expanding Martian settlement, and perhaps one day, the terraforming of the Red Planet into a second home for humanity. To achieve this lofty goal, there are many hurdles that SpaceX needs to overcome in the next few years. They need to learn how to launch people into space and keep them alive for extended periods of time. They need to figure out how to finance human missions to Mars, especially given that most government initiatives are currently focused on the moon. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, they need to create a next-generation spacecraft capable of sending large amounts of cargo and many people to the surface of Mars. The good news is that just in the last few months, SpaceX have made great progress on all three of these challenges. First, while SpaceX is certainly no stranger to launching payloads into orbit, with 71 Falcon 9 launches to date, they are now on the verge of becoming the first company to launch astronauts into space. In March, SpaceX launched the Dragon 2, or Crew Dragon, into space, becoming the first human-rated commercial spacecraft to visit the International Space Station. Although no astronauts were aboard for this initial demonstration flight, the mission successfully docked with the space station, deorbited, and splashed down in the Atlantic Ocean 6 days after launch. The data collected from this flight, especially from sensors attached to a life-size dummy aboard the flight, will provide important information to refine the design of Dragon 2. Though this mission was a stunning success, unfortunately, just 6 weeks after Dragon 2 returned to Earth, it was destroyed during a vibration simulator test. It still isn't entirely clear what caused the failure, which happened just before an escape thruster was due to ignite. So SpaceX and NASA are currently conducting a joint investigation to identify what caused the fault. Now, what this means in practice is that a scheduled in-flight abort test, which had planned to use this Dragon capsule, will have to be delayed, and unfortunately that also means that the first crewed Dragon 2 flight, which had been scheduled for July, will have to be pushed back. Realistically, this probably means that SpaceX won't fly astronauts until early 2020, but we'll have to wait for official confirmation of the dates later this year. In any case, whatever caused this failure to happen, it's actually encouraging that this happened before any people were on board so that no lives were at risk. There'll certainly be some important lessons to learn from this, and overall it should mean that SpaceX will be a much safer provider once people do actually take to flight. But if we want to go beyond Earth orbit and onto Mars, the second key challenge is how to finance the missions. When you consider that SpaceX's development of Dragon 2 was aided by a $2.6 billion contract from NASA, the lack of similar governmental funding for human Mars landers leaves SpaceX in the situation of potentially having to self-fund the development of spacecraft for Mars missions. Currently, a large fraction of SpaceX's revenue comes from launching commercial satellites into various orbits and cargo to the International Space Station. In fact, their launch revenue last year alone has been estimated at $2 billion, more than any other launch provider. And this capability is continuing to expand, with April seeing the first commercial flight for a paying customer of the world's most powerful rocket, the Falcon Heavy. And although SpaceX's launches are amongst the cheapest in the world already, the proven reusability of the first stage cores for both Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy launches enabled SpaceX to save more money on each flight, and hence devote an increasing fraction of their resources towards research and development for their Mars endeavours. However, launch revenue alone is not sufficient if you want to bankroll large-scale missions to Mars. SpaceX have another ambitious plan which will dramatically increase their available funding. This is Starlink, a constellation of 12,000 low Earth orbit satellites to provide internet to the entire world. Planned to be complete by 2027, Starlink will provide up to 50% faster internet speeds than current fiber optic cables at an affordable price anywhere on the world, be it land, sea, or air. Just a few days ago, on March 24th, SpaceX began constructing the Starlink constellation with the launch of the first 60 satellites on board a Falcon 9 rocket. Each Starlink satellite has a mass of 227 kilograms, is powered by a 3-kilowatt solar panel, and has a bandwidth around 17 gigabits per second. After deploying at a 440-kilometer altitude, each satellite uses a Krypton ion drive to raise themselves to their operational 550-kilometer orbit. This choice of a Krypton ion drive, instead of the usual xenon, reduces the propellant cost by around 5 to 10 times, whilst maintaining the impressively efficient specific impulse of 1500 seconds. Now, given the relatively low orbits of the Starlink satellites, and the sheer numbers involved, the risk of collisions with orbiting debris and space junk is naturally a concern. But this is actually another area where the ion drive is crucial, as it allows each satellite to autonomously change its orbit in order to avoid collisions in space, and even to de-orbit itself over a few months towards the end of their life. And should, for whatever reason, a satellite become inoperable, residual drag at such low orbital altitudes will cause the orbits to naturally decay, with the satellite re-entering the atmosphere within 5 years. SpaceX are planning up to 5 more Starlink launches this year alone. So by the end of this year, the first 360 satellites could be in place. Once 400 satellites reach orbit, potentially within the next 12 months, a limited internet service may begin for the United States. By the time 800 satellites are in position, moderate global coverage will begin, with an estimated 1,000 required before the constellation begins to pay for itself. Under an agreement with the US government's Federal Communications Commission, SpaceX need to launch at least 2,200 satellites by a deadline in April 2024, with the remaining 10,000 satellites in place by November 2027. Suffice it to say that this will be a colossal undertaking, requiring on average 2 Falcon 9 launches every month from now until 2027, with an estimated cost of $10 billion to complete the constellation. Whilst this may seem like a lot up front, SpaceX have actually already raised over $1 billion since the beginning of this year, which, when you combine that with previous investments, puts them in a strong financial position to build this constellation. And the potential rewards are huge, with an estimated profit of $30 to $50 billion per year after completion, about 10 times SpaceX's estimated launch revenue at that point. Starlink therefore represents a cornerstone in SpaceX's plans to sustainably fund human missions to Mars. Which brings us on to the most exciting aspect of SpaceX's vision, the development of Starship, the spacecraft they plan to use to send the first people to Mars in the 2020s. In brief, SpaceX are developing a rocket system composed of two parts, a 55-meter upper stage called Starship and a 67-meter booster called Super Heavy, with the combined system capable of transporting up to 100 tons of cargo or 100 passengers to Mars. If you're interested in more details about the design of Starship, Super Heavy, and how the combined system will enable travel to Mars, you can find those in previous Mars mission updates, like the one up there. But today, I want to focus on the latest developments in the construction and testing of the first Starship prototypes. SpaceX have come a long way since the last Mars mission update in December. In January, they completed the structure of a Starship prototype called Starhopper in Texas. Standing 39 meters tall, Starhopper will test SpaceX's Raptor engines in a realistic flight environment by conducting brief hop tests where the vehicle ascends, hovers, and then returns to land. One of the most striking things to note is that Starhopper has been built out of steel, which is a rather unusual choice in the aerospace industry today. Originally, Starship was designed to be made out of lightweight carbon fiber composites, so the choice to switch to the heavier option of steel may at first seem rather counterintuitive. Elon Musk recently clarified the reasoning behind this choice, and in short, it largely comes down to the material behaviour of certain alloys of steel. In particular, an alloy called 301 stainless steel, which has a high nickel and chromium content, has highly desirable properties both at cryogenic temperatures and at the highly elevated temperatures experienced during atmospheric entry. Since SpaceX chills their propellants to around minus 200 Celsius to increase their density, the material lining the fuel tanks needs to not become brittle at these temperatures. Unlike regular steel, which certainly does, 301 stainless steel actually becomes 50% stronger at these cryogenic temperatures. Considering now high temperatures, steel also benefits enormously from its higher melting point, allowing it to reach around 900 Celsius while maintaining its structure, which compares to just 200 Celsius for carbon fiber composites. But during atmospheric entry, where temperatures can exceed 1500 Celsius, additional heat shielding is required. So the side of Starship which is directly exposed to the flow during entry, also called the windward side, will therefore be coated in a series of hexagonal tiles, which have already been successfully tested up to 1400 Celsius. But should the tiles experience higher temperatures, small outlets will either leak liquid water or liquid methane, effectively allowing the rocket to sweat in a process called transpiration cooling. The side opposite the flow, also known as the leeward side, experiences lower temperatures and so doesn't require these tiles or the transpiration cooling system. This system offers two major benefits. First, the higher melting point of steel means a reduced overall heat shield mass, which more than compensates for the higher weight from choosing steel as your material. And secondly, the hexagonal tiles with transpiration cooling don't need to be replaced or refurbished after every single flight, as is the case with ablative heat shields, so Starship will therefore feature the first regenerative heat shield, making the spacecraft completely and rapidly reusable. Back to the Starhopper. In March, the first Raptor engine was installed on the Starhopper in Texas. Now you'll notice that the top half of the hopper is missing, which is unfortunately because the nose cone blew over during some high-speed winds in late January. So the fuel tanks were instead just installed in the bottom section alone, which won't hinder the testing. In the first phase of hop tests, only a single Raptor engine will be fired, whilst later tests will use three engines. The current Starship design will eventually host six Raptor engines, three optimized for sea level operation and three optimized for vacuum operation, with testing of the vacuum Raptor engines due to commence around September. In April, Starhopper underwent its first static fire test, followed a few days later by the first tethered hop. The Raptor engine has since been detached and sent to a lab for disassembly in order to assess its performance. Currently, it is expected that a new Raptor engine will be installed shortly, with hops due to resume in about a week's time. While the first Starhopper has been undergoing testing, SpaceX have already begun constructing the next prototypes. At the same site in Texas, the first Starship prototype theoretically capable of reaching orbit is also being assembled. The orbital Starhopper will be a full-size Starship prototype, 55 meters tall and 9 meters in diameter, with a thicker shell and shock absorbers installed on its landing legs. Meanwhile, a second orbital Starhopper is being assembled in Florida by an independent team, which will share progress and insights with the Texas team, but ultimately they will pursue different build techniques. If all goes well, then the body of the Texas orbital Starhopper should be complete in June, with propellant tanks, landing legs, and support for Raptor engines added soon afterwards. Bearing in mind that the first Starhopper construction only started late last year, it is seriously impressive to see how rapidly SpaceX are developing this new vehicle. Indeed, production of the first Super Heavy booster could begin as soon as August. So by the end of this year, SpaceX may not be far off having a full-scale test article for the combined Starship and Super Heavy system. We'll learn more about the details of the latest design, any changes involved, and about the testing of Starship in a few weeks' time at a presentation Elon Musk has planned currently for June 20th. And of course, I'll provide a summary of this in the next Mars Mission Update. So that brings us to the end of this update.